I have to admit, when I first watched Thor Ragnarok back in 2018, I had mixed opinions towards the character Thor when it comes to its solo movies, mainly at the fact that this was the very first Thor movie I watched before the first Thor movie and the Dark World. Mostly the fact that this feels mostly a different movie, that Thor and Loki went to a different planet than just doing something straight out of the Thor comics. Granted, Sakaar and the Grandmaster were probably part of those comics, but when it comes to the origins of Thor and his history with the other characters in those comics, I thought I was expecting something like in the first two Thor movies, but apparently Thor time needs to be a lot more different compared to the first two movies. And just by watching all the MCU movies up until this film, I really feel like that everything has basically come together when it comes to Thor's arc, even though that he's going to be returning in the fourth or fifth phase of the MCU. But that's mostly a story for a different time. To be perfectly honest, this is pretty much one of the most underrated films from not only from the Thor films, if you want to think that this is better than the first film, but mostly in the Thor phase of the MCU. Mostly the fact that for the direction that the characters are going to, by going to a different planet that they didn't mean to go, all because of Hela who's about to destroy Asgard, along with having Thor meet Hulk who has been stranded since after the events of Age of Ultron. This film was a lot more physical when you completely look at these moments and just ignore most of the funny moments, which shouldn't be a problem with you if you've been able to look at the funny moments and look at the emotional moments, but to be quite honest, people mostly remember this movie from being humorous, which I don't usually blame them if that's what they mostly want from the MCU movies, but the thing is, I think that the comedy in the MCU has become a major factor since day one. Anyway, Thor meets Doctor Strange in order to get some information on trying to meet his father again, but apparently, this also leads to Hela about to take advantage against the other characters because of the fact that she is probably one of the most OP characters in any other franchise. And believe me, she is way more unstoppable. She's probably on the same lengths as Thanos. Granted, she doesn't do much after this film, knowing that she ends up getting killed due to the apocalypse happening in Asgard. But on the other hand, if she was actually having some kind of revengeance in the Leo films, which I'm pretty sure it won't happen, I'm pretty sure that Thor and the other characters will deal with the same problematic situation as what they were dealing towards the final moments of this film. Considering that Hela is one of the most menacing villains in this franchise, I really found it difficult to believe that she was strong enough to take down Thor and the other characters, but the only way for Thor and the other characters to win is to sacrifice the homeland. I don't know if that's mostly a good thing or a bad thing, but considering that they learned that Asgard is mostly a place and not much of a home or anything, and they need to find a different location to live, this really sums up of what the other characters mostly are doing in Avengers Endgame. They couldn't be able to find a different location to live in after the old home has completely destroyed, and knowing that in the fourth Thor movie, well, we're going to see these characters return, I think it actually sums up onto why some of these characters are returning in future installments. Say all you want that Endgame is supposed to wrap up everything, but let's be real. As much as Endgame was a great movie back in 2019, but as of now, even though that Avatar completely beat that film when it comes to box office performance, I'm pretty sure that the MCU is fine continuing, but I'm gonna get to all that in Far From Home. So before we completely get into the major plots of this film, let's get into this scene where Thor and Jane break up, which explains onto why Jane and her friends or family are not part of this film. I don't know if it's either the fact that the reception that they got involving the Dark World is what causes them to scrap the original plans, but in all honesty, I didn't find those characters really unlikable. Granted, I gave Thor the Dark World a little bit too much credit, but in all honesty, some films in the MCU will mostly need to start somewhere and they need to do some fixes in order to make a future installment much more improving. And believe me when I say this, for someone who watched all the films, especially during the time while the Infinity Saga is complete, I would miss something that is mostly important when someone completely takes it out of the franchise because of mostly of the reception that the Dark World had. I have to admit that even if that's what productions are supposed to do in order to fix mistakes or by removing those mistakes, but on the other hand, I really feel like that this movie will probably be no different if Jane and most of the other characters from the previous Thor movies actually appear in this film, but that will probably make the film a little bit more claustrophobic. But it won't hurt to try. So let's get into Valkyrie. Valkyrie making her very first appearance in this movie, I have to admit that when I first watch her, she's mostly something that could be used for being exclusive towards film like Quicksilver from Age of Ultron. But knowing that she actually has a backstory, just like most of the other characters in this franchise, which leads to her being solo and spend most of her life in Sokoa, I really feel like they just she's probably one of the most important characters for future installments. For me personally, the fact that I actually get to learn about her backstory, because believe me, I had to rewatch this film because I mostly missed bits and pieces involving Valkyrie's backstory, and the fact that I didn't remember much about the final climax of this film. So, just witnessing most of this film really is more when it comes to other supporting characters like Valkyrie. Granted, she's not my favorite female Avenger, but I would rather save a different video involving ranking my favorite female Avengers, but I'm probably never going to do that. Believe me when I say this, is that Sokoa, being mostly a very futuristic city, which is somewhat on the same levels as the Guardians of the Galaxy planets when it comes to technology, I have to admit that they have a mixture of people mostly being in the way old times, like the ancient times, while they have no technology, but also in a futuristic sense, where most of the equipment and ships that they have are slightly improving. And believe me, I really feel like that the world building in Sokoa is a combination of old elements from the past, but also close to the modern times. But let's get into Bruce Banner, who finally returns after the events of Age of Ultron. Except that he's still as the Hulk. Let me tell you, the idea of having the Hulk being as the Hulk for nearly 2 years while Bruce Banner just doesn't usually remember a lot over these last 2 years really does give more character involving Bruce Banner because he has two faces, one of Bruce Banner and the other is Hulk. And in the other MCU movies, they do have that, but they never took this route. Not to mention that the Hulk has complete sentences. Knowing that they're trying to take inspiration from one of the TV shows where Hulk actually talks, but he doesn't usually gets angry all the time, this really feels similar to the cartoons, and I did watch those when I'm mostly familiar with the character. And just by watching this character being displayed in this film, I have to admit, I had mixed feelings before, but learning about most of the information now, I feel like it's really accurate. Granted, I found it hard to believe that Bruce was in this position for nearly 2 years that he wasn't able to control himself, but in all honesty, if he was actually part on Earth, I'm pretty sure that the people wouldn't do much with him. If he was part of the airport fight in Civil War, he would probably crush everyone immediately in order to stop the Civil War entirely. Besides, I don't even think he would be able to pick a side between Captain America or Iron Man, knowing that he has no clue who Bucky is. Although I will say that this will be the final time we're gonna be seeing Hulk doing so much action sequences. While in Infinity War, He's mostly gone, but it has an explanation. But I'm gonna get most of that once I get into that film and Endgame in March. This has to be one of the most bizarre but mostly shallow planets I have ever seen, and it's from an MCU movie and not Star Wars. I really think that the effort that the animators did in order to make this planet unique in its own way, but not being on the same levels as Guardians of the Galaxy, there was somewhat of a unique direction that they took in order to make Sakaar a really good planet for being its own thing. Granted, when it comes to most of the elements inside of the buildings, it's kind of weird, but let's be real, Thor doesn't really like red and white, which is something that he doesn't really prefer, which I'm pretty sure that if anyone who was in Thor's place in this, they will probably relate to most of the things that he doesn't like in Sakaar. I will talk about the Grand Master who takes over Sakaar and mostly taking control of the Hulk because he's becoming a fan favorite in this planet. But the thing is, there's really nothing to discuss knowing that he's mostly here for this one film and he's mostly for comic relief's sake. Not by any means to disrespect Jeff Goldblum who plays the Grand Master in this film, but the thing is, I have less to talk about his character, knowing that he's mostly here just to control the city of Sakaar while completely preventing Thor or the other characters from leaving. Besides, the end credits really feels a lot more awkward, even if it's supposed to be humorous. I would say much about this film, especially with its villain, but the thing is, I really feel like that this movie felt like a long time coming involving the end of Asgard, not to mention that this leads to the events of Infinity War. Not to say that this film has less to talk about because there are a few elements that I'm missing, but in all honesty, they're not really that important to be quite honest. I did like the evacuation in Asgard, not to mention the space fight sequence towards the end where the characters need to escape Sakaar, but in all honesty, everything in this film really feels like a typical MCU movie, even if it does contribute something into the plot. And whenever I say something, I don't usually have anything else to say regarding its elements. Believe me when I say this, when I completely see a villain about to take over Asgard, but then this leads to that villain completely killing herself because of a huge counter that the characters have in order to escape with safety, there's really nothing I have for an opinion off of this movie. Sure, there are Thor and Loki moments, but let's be real, that happened in the last Thor movie, so it's not really anything different here other than we get to see more fan service. Granted, I applaud the moments between Thor and his father, especially this leads to Thor becoming much more powerful towards the end when he makes a comeback. But the thing is, considering that this is going to be mostly involving Thor's future development in the later films, I really feel like that this moment has really aged a lot more onto why the MCU is going to be continuing even after Avengers Endgame. So I'm giving this film a 7.5 out of 10, and with that, I'm gonna be taking a break of MCU movies for this month. Granted, I review 5, but since we're halfway there, stay tuned as I review Black Panther in the following month to celebrate Black History Month, and we're gonna be wrapping everything up in March.